shall know them by their fruits. Do men gather grapes of thorns, or figs of thistles? Even so every good tree bringeth forth good fruit, but a corrupt tree bringeth forth evil fruit. A good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit, neither can a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. Every tree that bringeth not forth good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire. Wherefore, by their fruits you shall know them. This is telling us to beware of the false prophet. Now, a prophet at the time this was written wasn't just someone who can foretell the future. Actually, more often the word prophet meant someone who proclaims a message. And in our case, we're talking about proclaiming God's message. A proclaimer. So we need to beware of false proclaimers, of false preachers, and false teachers. It talks about them being in sheep's clothing. That means they're not what they seem. Some people can sound really good and look really good, but we need to be careful. Verse 16 talks about knowing them by their fruits. Now, most often we think of fruits as their character or their deeds, what they do. And that is a really good way we measure fruits. But in the context we have here, it's also talking about their doctrine, what they teach. That can be more poisonous than their character. We look a little further into this, and it starts talking about a corrupt tree, which is the false teacher. What does the word corrupt mean? It has some different definitions. One is decayed. A corrupt tree is worthless. It's unusable. Now, if you are the gardener of an orchard, if you have a corrupt tree that is decayed or diseased, you need to do swift removal so that it doesn't infect the rest of your orchard. So what's Jesus telling us? We need to watch out for these corrupt trees. And we don't necessarily get to handle them or should handle them the way Deuteronomy tells us in chapter, I think it's 13. The days of killing the false teacher is a little past for us. But that was God's plan at that time. If anybody tried to lead his people away from him, they were to be put to death. But we need to be on guard. That's what he started with. Jesus told us to begin with in this section to beware. Take heed. What's going on? Listen to what's said. Look what's being done. Pay attention. False teachers were in the time of Jesus. They were before Jesus. They were there during the time of the apostles. They're here today. And we can look at them and some of what they hope to do, why they're doing this. Why are they a false teacher? And again, there's three things we can look at. One of the things is they do it for gain. They're interested in money. The love of money. There's an old country song that one line out of it, and it just came to my mind right then. I didn't have this one in my notes. But he said, he told him to send his money to Jesus, but he gave me his address. And there's some of them that do that. And a lot of times we think of just the TV evangelist when this comes into play, but there's more than that. We look at John chapter 10, verses 12 and 13. It says, "But he that is an hireling and not the shepherd, whose own sheep are not, seeth the wolf coming and leaveth the sheep and fleeth. And the wolf catches them and scattereth the sheep. The hireling fleeth because he is a hireling and careth not for the sheep." Now that hireling is like a false teacher. His interest is not in the sheep or in the flock. He is self-interest. They're more interested in themselves than they are in you or me or anyone in the flock. If you listen and watch their attitude says that they are the most important. And don't you forget it. They're interested in self. You know, generally speaking, we can know a teaching is false if it consists of observing external things and confuses religion with religious practices. They emphasize works, what you can do. And you know, that works are very important. We do them because we have received salvation. We can't repay God. But we can help and do good things for others. False teaching generally consists only of prohibitions or thou shalt not. You cannot be a Christian by abstaining from things. Christianity is a doing religion. Jesus called us to go, to do, to follow. If you notice, when he was speaking to disciples, he always used action words to begin the relationship with them. What did he say to Matthew? Follow me. That's pretty direct, pretty simple. Generally speaking, a teaching is false if it produces an easy religion. You can do whatever you want to. Your physical part is different than the spiritual part. You know, that is an old teaching. Brother Greg Young mentioned the Gnostics Sunday night. That was one of the teachings they had. They thought they could separate what they did from what they believed, their spiritual life from their physical life. They could be as evil as they wanted to as long as they were keeping their mind pure with their part of their thinking. And you know, that's as foolish as can be. A false teaching will try to separate religion and life, which is what we're talking about just before that. John 17:15 says, I pray not that thou shouldst take them out of the world, but thou shouldst keep them from the evil, or the evil one. You know, if Jesus was done with us when we were saved, there would be no reason for us to stay. We could all just go on home. But we have a purpose. God has something for us to do. He wants us to be about his business. As Jesus said, he was to be about the Father's business. So are we. You know, we throw the word Christian around pretty easy sometimes and pretty thoughtlessly. But the word Christian means Christ-like. And when I think about that, I don't feel like I deserve to be called Christian. I am not Christ-like. The only goodness I have is what goodness has come from him, through him, and by him. But I'm proud of him. Another thing we can tell is that their followers of a false teacher usually become arrogant and separatist. They want to separate themselves from other people. They want to show that they're better than other people. You know, some religions, this is easy to see this in. The Scientologist, this is a big part. You have to be in that inner circle. You have to separate yourself from others. You have to do all these different things, these works, to move up and be closer. Jesus does not want us to be separate. He certainly doesn't want us to be arrogant. We're to be inclusive, not exclusive. You know, the more people we can get into God's house, the better it is. We don't want to separate ourselves. We want to separate ourselves from the stain of the world, but not from the world, because the world needs us. We need to be in the world where people can see us and relate to us and have confidence in us. Now, when people have confidence in you, look out. They're going to come and tell you things you don't want to know. They're going to feel confident in asking you for help God gives society what they want in order to punish them. And punishment comes with many of these things. But Paul knew that there were going to be false teachers. And look where he says they come from. Among you, also of your own selves shall men arise, people who claim to be believers. And that's the most hurtful of all. They hurt people who are believers, but worse yet, they hurt people who are not yet believers. They turn people away from Christ by what they say and what they do. Paul told Timothy in 1 Timothy 4:1 and 2, "Now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of evil, speaking lies in hypocrisy." It's not hard to find that if you'll just listen and pay attention. Turn the TV on, listen to the radio. That's the easiest places. But you can also hear it in groups of people. If you didn't hear anything like that in your workplace, you were blessed. And I was blessed where I worked. And Carl can attest to this, and Donnie could if he was here. We had a bunch of preachers in amongst our number. And it helped. Didn't take care of all the rough language or all the things that went on, but it helped. And a few years ago, people had more respect for preachers than they do today. Just like they did for the church than what they do today. In 1 John chapter 4, verses 1 through 3, John is speaking and tells us, because I think this is what Jesus has told him to tell us, "Beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits whether they are of God, because many false prophets are gone out into the world. Hereby know ye the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesseth that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is of God. And every spirit that confesseth not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is not of God. And this is that spirit of Antichrist, whereof ye have heard that it should come, and even now already is it in the world." Now, this was at the time of John. So if it was in the world then, it certainly is in the world today. We go back early in that verse and he says, "But try the spirits." That word "try" means to test. You're going to test it, you're going to have to make a judgment. Now, part of what he tells us here that we can make the judgment from is pretty easy. If they preach Jesus and him crucified and him risen from the dead, they've got God's message. Then if you place your faith in him for salvation, that's God's plan. If they're doing any